Well, welcome to Turkey Teams this morning. My name is Ian. I'm the transitional pastor here, and I join everybody else here to give you a warm welcome. A couple quick announcements I want to share with you this morning. If you look on the back of your bulletin, Randy Kistner's mother passed away. The family's gathering in Michigan for her memorial service and committal. We will give you that date. We had not received it at the time of publishing the bulletin. Also, let you know that next week we'll be offering Holy Communion. So it's important to stop and reflect upon your life and prepare your heart and ask God to prepare your heart to receive what we remember as the Lord Jesus' sacrifice for our sins as we commemorate that in the bread and in the juice. So I commend that to you. If you're a visitor today, I'd ask you to take this welcome card and fill it out and send it in, or put it in the offering plate when it comes around. If we don't do that here, put it in the box at the back and see whether or not we respond to you. It's kind of a test for us administratively. We like to be tested. We like to be tried. We like to see if we can deliver. So just put in your mother's address. Put in your neighbor's address. That's fine. And we'll respond to them. But the thank you for attending. It's really messes with their mind. It'll be good fun for you. It'll be good fun for me. This is what it looks like. And at this point, Kate Menzies is going to come and share with you the Quadruple F event this coming Friday, which I can never say.
Is it senor or senorita?
Senorita.
I'm going to tell you.
Good morning, everyone. My name is Kate Ment. I'm on the education committee here at the Kirk. I joined the church back in February, I believe. And I was asked to have this be part of this group, and I'm really happy to be part of it. We've been through a hard time here after Corona. There are some of us that are still waiting for house repairs and health to get better. I know there's been a lot of coughing going on from the debris and whatnot. And we in the education committee are trying to come up with an event every month. It's the first Friday Family Fun. That's the quadruple F, which I now will use. Anyway, coming up in May, I told you the last time I was up here that as soon as we knew what the theme would be, then we would let you know, and we're going to put up a sign-up sheet, so we know how many people are coming. We're working out the bugs even yet. Well, this month will be very easy, because the first Friday is the 4th of May. And we know what the 5th of May is. Thank you. It is going to be a Cinco de Mayo celebration in that it's going to be very colorful. It's going to be very fun. We're going to do a little Mexican hat dancing and piñata. And if you want to dress up in your bright, colorful clothing, the most colorful clothing you have, come and be part of our celebration. It's a 1.5-hour commitment once a month. It's not a lot of time. In fact, when we get together, we have time to, first of all, get to know each other. Second of all, share a meal with each other. And third of all, just have fun. Cinco de Mayo is a holiday that is a celebration of the independence of Mexico from the French regime under Napoleon III. I'm going to call this recovery or celebration for getting through Roma. I have a sign-up sheet which I will put up in the back. It lost an eye on the way here, so you're just now. But if you would sign up, then we could have enough food for everyone. And that's really what we'd like to have. So thank you for your time, and please come at the quadruple F if you can. Thank you.
Thank you, Kate. Let's take a minute to greet one another. Here's with this condition. Greet somebody you don't know. Because at the end of the service, when they have that wild and desperate look on their face and they're racing for the exit, you might not be able to stop them. But they're trapped now, so go get them.
Because do you know that there were lots of times they asked Jesus who the greatest one of them was going to be? And Jesus told them that it's the least of these. So that means that you need to be humble. And humble means that you shouldn't be bragging on and for anything else. You brag? Humble means patient, very good. Yes. Well, much to the chagrin of many of the adults out there, I'm gonna stand up and turn around for just a minute. So hang on, okay? Do you know what it is? It's called the NFL Draft. And that's why I'm wearing my shirt today. Because there are a whole bunch of young men right now that are hoping that they're going to be the greatest, that they're going to join the greatest team. They've been really good when they've been playing college football. And they think that they're the greatest. But do you know that not all of them are going to get picked? Because there aren't enough spaces on all the teams for all. And some of them are already disappointed because they thought they were the greatest and they haven't been picked yet. My very favorite player right now, when he was picked in the year 2000, and there are some people that call him a goat. I'm not talking about a goat that, you know, climbs a mountain. Do you know what goat stands for? Greatest of all time.
Yeah.
He was picked number 199 in the year 2000. Yes, Miss Patty knows that it's Tom Brady. And as much as football is kind of fun, and I'm having fun with the adults this morning, there are lots of things that Mr. Brady has done. Like, do you know that a few years ago, he asked to have his salary cut? So he took less money so that they could have different and better men, people on the team, men on the team, because there's only a certain amount of money that each NFL team can have. So he became part of the team, that it was important for him. So when you start to think about how maybe you don't get picked first for a, maybe you don't get picked first for a team, or you don't get the A on the test, that you need to remember that part of it is being humble and patient, thank you, Evan, to be part of the kingdom of God. Will you pray with me about this? Dear God, thank you for giving us Jesus, who showed us that he was the least of all. By dying for our sins. We are not worthy of him putting us before him. Thank you, God, for Jesus. And for helping us to understand that humility is the greatest of all. In Jesus' name, amen.
Thank you. Hallelujah, and so
And he's reading a letter that comes from his wife while he's on station in the Caribbean. And she says, "Dearest Horatio." And the author says, that would mean that she had at least two other husbands as well at the same time. Because it's dear, you all know this from school, then it's dearer, and then it's dearest. So every time he'd read that, he would smile because he would say, she doesn't know this, but she's confessing she has two other husbands. So that's why I said dearest today, and none of you care a lick for what I've just said. Those of you who are into literary construction have profited hereby. I just want you to know that. John chapter 9, beginning of verse 1. As he, Jesus, went along, he saw a man blind from birth. His disciples asked him, "Rabbi, who sinned, this man or his parents, that he was born blind?" "Neither this man nor his parents sinned," said Jesus. "But this happened so that the work of God might be displayed in his life. As long as it is day, we must do the work of him who sent me. Night is coming when no one can work. I am in the world. I am the light of the world." Having said this, he spit on the ground and made some mud with saliva and put it on the man's eyes. "Go," he told him, "wash in the pool of Siloam." This word means sent. So the man went and washed and came home seeing. Let's pray. Father, this morning, I pray that you would find a way today to intersect your word in our lives. Teach us, inform us, direct us, correct us, but most of all, allow us to see, hear, and feel that these are the words of life and we need to hear them. For this we pray in Jesus' name, amen. I wanted to talk to Sandy before the service this morning because I saw her t-shirt and I was offended by it. It said, if you didn't read, New England Patriots. Anybody ever heard of the team? Kind of a minor league team in many places. A friend of mine put something on Facebook. Now, she also mentioned Tom Brady, who played for anybody? No. University of Michigan? Great quarterback for University of Michigan. Drafted 199. Hard to believe. But he put something on Facebook that said the number of players drafted in the first two rounds from the University of Michigan, and he had a big O for Ohio. Anybody get that? Ohio hates Michigan. They're haters. I thought that was interesting. For 10 years, I lived outside Philadelphia. Philadelphia, you remember Philadelphia? That's the team that beat New England in the Super Bowl. Thank you very much. I have a theory regarding that. When I was there, my church was right around the corner from the Flyers practice facility. And so we had a number of the Flyers, the Philadelphia Flyers, live in the community. And I gotta tell you, those were some monstrous people. And every once in a while, I would go to the practice facility and I would stand next to the glass. Any hockey fans here? Oh my goodness, I live in a foreign land with desert people. So if you go right up against the glass, it's already a little bit off the ice, and you're looking, and these guys are skating around, and all of a sudden they slam into the boards in front of you, and it's like a Mack truck is just banged into the wall, and those guys are going at high speed, and they mean business. So that was fun, and so we were around that particular culture. But just down the road was my best friend was there. He was a Southern Baptist. He was a drinking, swearing Southern Baptist, which was an interesting combination of people. But he was the chaplain for the Eagles. And so once in training camp, he asked me if I would like to do chaplain service for him. And I said, well, I don't know. Yes. So I went into chaplain.